So our program's built on sort of five philosophical points in that it is a master's of science degree, which means that once you leave our program, if you want to go on to PhD studies, you're prepared for that. If you don't and just want to go out in the professional world, we haven't taught you a bunch of theoretical researchy stuff. We've taught you applied GIS, curriculum, and you'll be prepared to do stuff, but also prepared to take on more researchy things too, because we cover sort of the rigorous fundamentals. We're built on a cohort model, and a cohort model is very much sort of everybody comes in, takes the same courses. You work along as a team. You're taking all the same classes in the same room in the same order, which does a couple of cool things for us. As faculty, we know exactly what you've learned because so we don't have to do that thing that goes for the first 2 or 3 weeks of every class where you said, I know that you probably don't remember anything from intro to GIS, so let's do it all over again. And so we can shave off all that stuff, and which is kind of repetitive. It means that the courses you're taking courses with people who will become friends most of the time, sometimes not, but you build a close personal relationship with these folks. And then there's some people who are good programmers, there's some people who are great cartographers, there are people who understand stats and numbers, good remote sensors. So whatever your background, you're bringing that and sharing it with the class. So it becomes a huge support network working on together. It also means the way that we bring a cohort in January and another one in September. And so you're always overlapping with two other cohorts. The one that's been there, the seniors, then you become the seniors and there's a new junior cohort. And that means that in your cohort, the maximum size cohort we can have, just because the room's too small, is 20 people. The smallest might be 10. But that cohort means that you're overlapping with the, let's say, 15 in your class, the 15 before and the 15 after. You've automatically got 45 professional associates when you leave and go get a job. So it's a huge network of support. It's immersive. Our program is a residential program. It takes about a year and a half of work maybe a 2-year normal Master of Science degree, folds it up and jams it into 11 months. And so there's 11 really intensive boot camp kind of months, and then you're done and out into the job market. There's a mentorship relationship. Our faculty, we have 5 faculty who are here on campus almost every day. You'll be assigned or develop a mentor relationship with one of them. They'll help you with your projects. And so we're there to help you get over the humps and explain things to you in a way that many master's systems out or master's programs out there, you take a class from a professor and that maybe it's the last you see them. And it's rigorous. You will have to do stuff. You'll also understand why you're doing things. You'll learn the foundation theory. If you want a good example of somebody who survived this, Nate Strepp was one of our graduates. Yay, Nate. We'll pass this. We have systems and information technology available to our students and sort of huge resources there, I think. The IT department knows what our students need, and we have servers and technology and internet bandwidth and whole sort of things that you may have encountered in your classes so far. But we also work with a project management client model. That means you're going to develop a project and you're going to work, create a GIS for somebody else. So the advantage there is you have to learn how to understand somebody else's problem, how to develop software and requirements around that, how to get it done, write software, develop databases, create maps and graphics, learn how to explain that all to somebody at a conference. And so this project and this thing called a MIP, a major individual project, is something that each of our students does. The projects are on the order of 500 to 700 hours of work. So they're not a senior project. They're not a weekend project. They take up most of your last 4 months of time with the program. We believe in numbers, so we're an analytical quantitative group. Kind of leave the feelings at the door to send. But we're solving the world's problems in a provable way. That's how I put it. It's a scientific approach. And tackling some of the gnarly things out there. But we've done projects that have been working with Feed America to locate their food distribution warehouse in a new inefficient area so that they could serve more people. We've worked with Marine Habitat. We've worked with the Jane Goodall Institute. We've worked with
fire and police departments
yeah. Here in town. The Huntington Gardens mapping the irrigation there, yeah. And the rare plants they have. So we really sort of helped the Inland Empire, but also worked with a lot of NGOs around the world to do their GIS needs. Cohorts help with our support systems, I talked about. We have a set of apartments down on Central Avenue where a lot of our students live, so you kind of living in a living learning environment similar to Johnston. It takes 1 year, and this is in 1 year done, and you come out with a master's if you spend that 1 year. I would say that 50% of our students leave after 11 months with their degree done. 75% of our students finish within another year or two. And the reason that they don't finish is they did all the work, they defended, they just didn't rewrite their report and turn it in. And sometimes that takes a long time. I won't say anybody in this room might have done it that way. But life gets busy. You have kids. Anyway,
they get a really high-paying job.
They get a high-paying job, and it doesn't matter as much. I would say we have the resources for you to finish in a year. It's hard work, but a good number of people do. And our completion rate is better than than the national average by far. National average on science master's degrees of completion is about 45%, and 75% of ours finish. So you'll invest time and effort and money, and you'll get something at the end. Full-time faculty, so we have both full-time. We also have adjunct faculty that we hire mostly from ESRI, who come over and teach specialized topics that we don't have in-house or too busy to do. And then we have this really, 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 really strong relationship with ESRI that means that we get quite a bit of support. Can we announce Friday? Is that open to the general public?
Yeah, okay.
This group,
sure.
Okay, this course. So on Friday,
we don't want to broadcast this.
We don't want to broadcast it the whole name.
It's supposed to be cozy.
It's supposed to be a cozy relationship. Jack Dangerman, who's the president of ESRI, will be here in the Brown Auditorium having a conversation with students.
Amphitheater.
So. You're welcome to come and ask a Fortune 500 billionaire a few questions on life and success and things like that. So that's that. Esri Connection, yes. You want a picture with Jack? You can get a picture with Jack.
I'm wearing shorts in that picture. You can't see.
Yeah, Hawaiian.
Cut it off.
You all know the University of Redlands, but a lot of people I talked to don't know that it's not the University of Esri. So we'll just move on beyond that one. Again, mentoring and advising, which, believe me, you don't find at all programs. This is the basic division of your year. We offer courses in sort of these five areas, but really the curriculum is divided into theory courses where you learn the fundamentals of the history of GIS, why we have to work the way we do, how we might work otherwise in the future. Then applied stuff, there are 6 2X series courses, it's our applied GIS. And then we have this huge project that is 14 of the 42 credit hours in the program. So that's 1/3 of your time is working on your project. We have some GIS profession courses, workshops. Every one of our students who starts in September applies to give a presentation at the Esri conference. Most of them do. So you're presenting to 10,000 of your friends. Smaller groups for most of the presentations. And then we have a set of workshops where we deal with one day specialized topics. Steve came in and told everybody about drones in a day. Different topic, a variety of topics depending on what people want.
Naked a little bit.
Okay. I think, so the way that your life will go, and I'll probably wrap it up here, is that you'll take a lot of courses for the first half of a year that are kind of the ordinary classroom pieces, but then your project, you'll define it, you'll get everything in place, and then the last third of your time is taken up entirely getting this project done and written up. And then some workshops and professional stuff in the middle. So that's sort of how the program works. I've got brochures. Take questions.
Okay. Yeah, questions.
I think talk to Michelle. I don't know what she said. Most people like coming in. Do you see a group being or people liking to come in September versus another time? Do you know what I mean? Isn't there like two different?
There's a cohort that starts in September, and there's a cohort that starts in January.
Okay.
And I think the folks who start in September are best. But some people started in January.
Because if not in January, you just roll over into this.
The program runs all summer and all night and all day, and if you start in January, you just take most of the classes through the summer, and then you'll do your project mostly next fall. So there's no difference between those, but I would say that sort of the little thing, it says t-shirt, it's got my initials on it. If you talk to Andrea down there, she'll give you one of these great gray University of Redlands URGIS t-shirts. So if you need a t-shirt. The regular school year, there's a lot of excitement of starting new in September. And you've been doing that for 4 years, right? You take some time off in the summer and you start new. And there's a lot of energy there. The business cycle is sort of tuned to hiring that's sort of close to that too. They do a lot of their hiring during the late spring and summer. So if you're finishing in December, you've got a little bit of a lull before the hiring cycles begin. But the curriculum's the same. The the amount of energy required is the same. So, but we'd like you starting in September because that would fill up our cohort.
What kind of background is best for an undergrad coming directly into a master's program?
Well, I think.
Or what helps?
What else? I think you need, we have a requirement of one GIS course and work experience, or two GIS courses at an undergraduate level, an internship, and then no work experience. So some of our folks are coming in, you know, they're 32 and they've been doing GIS for 10 years and they want a new degree and that focuses a little bit on management maybe, or they want to retool. No GIS, they learned it one way, they've been doing one part of the job for 10 years and they want to do something new, for all kinds of reasons. Or you're folks like you who have discovered GIS and love it and want to do some more of it, and so we're looking for enough experience to sort of know why you want to be there. And so what I'd say is that what we have is that we have a very tough, demanding program, and at some point around the third or the fourth month, you're going to say, why am I putting up with all this? And if you've been in the profession, you know why you're putting up with it, because there's something good coming at the end. And if you're an undergraduate and you've only taken one course and you don't really know what GIS does, and you're really worried about why you're putting up, why don't I just go do something else, then we want you to get over that point and kind of say, I can see where I want to be at the end. And that comes from being more familiar with the technology. But having said that, have any of you worked with Matt Flewelling with the Center for Spatial Studies? Okay. Matt, Nate hired him. Matt did his undergraduate in studio arts photography. He did not know how to spell GIS when he came in, but he'd done okay, and you know, he'd done really well in undergraduate studies. He'd had some time off working in business for a little while, and he knew that he wanted to do this, and so I found that it was, even though he was my son, that it was very interesting to have him in class, because he knew that he didn't know anything. So he did all the readings, and he worked really hard. And in that 1 year, he went from not really knowing how to program to being a web programmer. And now he's doing apps for the university here and alumni relations and other things like that. He's become a programmer, he knows GIS. He took his photography skills and he did really well in remote sensing, because it's images and image analysis. So he was able to bridge all the skills he had into GIS and did really well and finished on time, except for the rewriting of the project. So even if you live in my house, I can't get you to finish on time. So anyway, I would say we had also your son Bryce.
My stepson Bryce was a creative writing major, no GIS background. I did slip him a few Esri online courses before he came, but that was after he applied for the MSGIS program. He's working for the county of Riverside now.
So I'd say that if you are a motivated, directed, good student, you don't need much. But if you're kind of you would ask, why are you going to grad school? And some people are going to grad school because they've been in school for the last 16 years and they can't imagine anything else. And they're going to totally get destroyed by our program because it really requires focus, determination. So you can't sort of plod along, because it moves so quickly you'll get lost. Now, but I assume that as graduates of the University of Redlands, you're going to be able to do that just fine. So, But if you have GIS background, if you've done some really interesting stuff, then we have this philosophy that we will meet you where you are. We have a standard that our students have to, this is Mark's approach, you have to get to our standard, but if you're already at our standard, we're going to really challenge you to rise far above it. So it's not just, you know, come here and get your degree. So if you know a lot of programming, we're going to ask for that next application you develop to be really pretty snazzy. If you know a lot about statistics and analysis, then we're going to look for some really advanced spatial analysis from you. So we want you to stretch while you're here. Okay. Other questions?
Okay, well, thanks.
Thanks.
Professor Llewellyn.
My office is directly across the courtyard. You'll see me in the window.
It's the one full of Legos.
It's the one full of Legos. And my area of study is I look at how spatial relations are used in board games and video games and analyze that sort of thing, which I'll have a lot more time for come July.
Okay, well, I think you introduced yourself already when I was out grabbing the clicker. So Jim, okay. Jim Pick from the School of Business. I'm director of the GISAB.
Hi, I'm Jim Pick from the School of Business, and I want to talk about the MBA program and the GIS emphasis in the MBA program. And this is another alternative for graduate study for you at the University of Redlands. And I think, you know, you should, considering U of R, the both alternatives, the program that Doug just presented, this program depends on your interests, really. And so I want to try to explain this program and take questions from you, of course. I do have some brochures which I'll hand out now because the curriculum may be less familiar to you. And there are plenty of copies also of this. So the MBA degree is a generic degree for business management. And what that means is that you'll be trained in 12 or 15 different areas of management skills, and you'll have a base in generic management that is really a worldwide credential for a business. And it's becoming important these days, more than it used to be, just to get into certain jobs. In addition, there's a GIS emphasis, which is a four-course sequence, four-unit courses. And that emphasizes the decision-making and analytics side of GIS. And some of the cartographic or geographic side, but much less than is in the MSGIS on the cartographic and geographic and that side of things. And this is not a new program because it's been at the University of Redlands for about 12 years. The GIS emphasis. The MBA has been at the U of R for over 25 years. And the GIS emphasis has had a lot of interest. We looked recently at about 175 graduates over time of the emphasis. We're averaging about 25 possibly 30 a year who are in the emphasis. The MBA program, by the way, has about 900 students enrolled in it, and so that's about 450 come into the MBA every year. And of those, about 25 to 30 have a specialization in GIS. I would mention that that the school has a mission or a strategic focus on GIS, and it wants to be, in a business school, it wants to be among the best in spatial thinking, learning, and research. And we think we made progress on this, and we have a dynamic period we're going into now for further growth that I'll talk about. And it's not as if so many business schools have MBA with GIS. So many of them have MBAs, but only a small number of them have the GIS emphasis. And that's partly because of business has not, business schools have not put enough emphasis on GIS over the years. So the present degree, this is what I want to cover in 15 minutes. And I'll do the best I can. So a little bit more background on the school, the degree offerings, some examples of the career benefits, and I wasn't able to bring along a graduate today, but we have them locally in Redlands, and if you want to meet one of them, that's easy enough to arrange. There's a new spatial business initiative in the school, and then discussion and questions. So this is a little bit background on the school. It has about 1,700 students. This is of the U of R student body, about 1,700 are in the School of Business. 26 full-time faculty and 100 part-time faculty. Part-time faculty are usually academically qualified. If they're not, they're professionally qualified. School is about 17 years old, and this is a very fortuitous time because 2 weeks ago, the School of Business received, for the first time, business school accreditation, which is a big step. That's beyond WASC accreditation, beyond the university's own accreditation. It has specialized business school accreditation now. And it offers these five programs, MBA, Master of Science in Information Technology, Master of Arts in Management, and two bachelor's degrees in business and in management. And the classes are taught in 8-week courses with meetings once a week from 6 to 10 in the evening. So you're, I think, used to day classes. So this would be a shift to evening classes. There is a nice break in there, about a half an hour or so. You don't have to be listening or sitting there for 4 hours straight. The GIS emphasis courses up till now have been taught in what is called a hybrid format. So those four GIS courses are taught half on the ground and half virtually. So every other week you meet in class, and the other weeks you meet in a virtual online environment. We also are developing currently a variation that will be of the GIS emphasis courses that will be 100% online. And the MBA as a whole is now available 100% online. So once the GIS emphasis finish, we think it'll be finished next fall. That'll mean you can go through the MBA on the ground, or you can potentially go through in an online MBA. But so far, predominantly we're on the ground for the MBA. We only have about 30 initial online students just getting started with that. We have four full-time faculty who teach in GIS, myself, Abhijit Sarkar, Meridad Kui Kamali, who's a new faculty, an amazingly talented GIS MIS faculty, and then Johannes Moenius, who's interested in spatial economics. We think we've pioneered among business schools in having a GIS theme in our school. I'll talk a little bit more about that. We've had thousands of undergraduates who have gone through with a core course now in GIS. And we have the 175 emphasis graduates. Faculty have done written textbooks in GIS, and they've done research in GIS and spatial studies of different types. There's some interesting history that I can go into if you want to, but I'll skip it for now. There have been grants and there have been special opportunities and projects that have come up in GIS and spatial ed. The point here is that students, particularly the graduate students, get involved with these projects. And I think it's been very helpful to some of them in their career progressions, and more about that. So here's an example. Marco Flores received his BS in business from our business school. Then he went on, he took the MBA with GIS emphasis, graduating last year. And he's recently been hired as a GIS specialist for Apple Computer. He's applying combined GIS expertise and business knowledge to a new and exciting project at Apple in the Silicon Valley. The reason I don't say what the project is that his company is not allowing him to say what the project is. This is his recent statement. I am happy to report, quote, I'm utilizing every inch of what I've learned from the U of R in a real world setting. So he really leveraged off of this space, and he's taken off, and we're very happy about him. Another distinguished graduate of our school in the GIS emphasis in the MBA is Costa Cada. He is a manager of industrial engineering at Disney Resorts, and he has responsibility to maintain world-class operations at two Disney theme parks, and that includes locational analysis of the complex park infrastructure. So they're optimizing their spatial resources, and they're reconfiguring them to have the biggest flows and the best experience for their customers. And he was so excited about his time in the GIS emphasis that he actually is on the School of Business Advisory Board, and he's given support to the school's GIS teaching and research. And then the third example is Jessica Rosales, who took her MBA with GIS emphasis in 2015. She also completed her BS in the School of Business. And she did very well academically, although when she came into her undergraduate, she knew nothing about GIS. Her background was, she was familiar with working in supermarkets. That was her background. And she leveraged all of this. She became a graduate assistant at one of our centers in GIS and worked on a federal research project with spatial. And she was hired by Esri right after she graduated and is now the coordinator of Esri's certificate program worldwide. So that's another exemplary graduate. They don't all do as well as these three, but it shows what can be the benefit of the program. This is what the curricular sequence looks like. And the way you read this is going from top to bottom on the left and then top to bottom on the right. So it is assuming that there's some very basic business courses that the student has taken before coming into the MBA. Now, if the student hasn't taken these several basic courses, Then what happens is the MBA stretches out to 2 years. If they have taken these basic courses and they're in this packet, they're listed in the packet, then the student enters this sequence that takes a year and a half. And what you can see here on the left are a base of some important business areas: accounting, finance, international business, business statistics, economics, and management, org behavior, ethics and society, and not to be forgotten, information and knowledge management. So sort of the first year is taken developing this MBA broad set of skills that I talked about at the beginning. Remember I said there was 15 areas? That's developing those 15 generic areas. And then the student has a choice of five different emphasis routes, one of which is the GIS emphasis. There are other ones listed in the brochure that you can look at and see if those are of interest. But the GIS emphasis is shown here. So there are four courses. A GIS for marketing is the first one. Spatial analysis for global business is the second 8-week course. Then sandwiched in between is a general analytics course, which covers big data and how you can use analytics to understand big data. That's a very hot topic nowadays in business schools. Then the last two GIS courses, contemporary planning for business GIS, emphasizes spatial analytics and big data. That's a little bit more specialized than generic analytics, and we're using Tableau software and Insights software from Esri in that course. And then it has some introduction to GIS planning in the course. And then the last course there is GIS strategy, concepts, and implementation. Student teams from the MBA go into small businesses, government offices, nonprofit organizations, and they do an 8-week planning project in GIS for the organization. And that, some cases, the organization has never had anything important spatially. So they have a team of 4 or 5 students who meet with management, do extensive planning, and come up with a design for GIS, and then they meet again in their final report of that course with the management to try to present the results. What they're not doing is they're not doing the comprehensive, detailed GIS top to bottom. But, you know, in some cases the company has then hired one or two of these people to do that kind of very deep programming and application work. An example of this would be a group team of students recently in last fall designed GIS application for the Institute for Industrial and Systems Engineering, which is a nationwide organization. Particular emphasis on their California chapter and how they could attract more members through marketing, through having site locations for meetings that were more effective, and through other means, and that went very successfully. And there'll be more work with the IISC, which is a huge national organization. Just one example of that. Finally, the last course in the MBA is sort of a multifaceted simulation course of MBAs who are trying to help businesses from a multiple perspective using simulation software. These are the goals of the GIS emphasis, these are not just business goals, these are also spatial goals to put into place spatial assessment, spatial decision making, spatial market segmentation, and other aspects that help businesses make use and get ahead with spatial. There's some information in these slides and also online about the details of these courses. And I'm not going to go over them unless you have questions about them in a few minutes. I'm not going to go over the details of them, but I think that they meet those objectives you've seen for the program, and I did explain in some detail this last course here, the course where teams come into organizations, and also this is the course that emphasizes spatial analytics and big data. Where do our students end up from our GIS emphasis? These are some places with spatial themes that students have ended up working in. GIS, we have many alumni who have been hired by ESRI from our emphasis, as of course does the MSGIS program. Utility companies, marketing design firms, including advertising design, defense and intelligence. One of our recent illustrious students sort of dropped off the radar screen a little bit because he's become very serious about being interviewed by the intelligence community. Accounting firms have hired our graduates, transportation. We have these graduates in local government, including County of San Bernardino as an example. One of the major spatial engineers comes out of our program. They're entrepreneurs who have founded small businesses who have come out. Not every small business has done well, but a few have. You can see with Apple Computer, high tech and software, and real estate. So there are a variety of industries that have GIS themes that our graduates have gone into. But I did want to make this note at the bottom, come back to what I said at the beginning, that the MBA degree is also a generic degree. So it covers these 15 areas. And so some of our graduates prefer to be generalists. So they'll go out and they can be hired for almost any MBA kind of a job. It may not be spatial. They prefer on finishing up that they want to be generalists. So that does happen as well. And that happens with all of our emphases as well. We have three centers for, two for GIS, one for ethics, and the Ethics Center has been sponsoring some specialized studies in spatial privacy, so they have some interest in GIS. We're undertaking in the next year and a half a spatial initiative to build up our school more in spatial than we have been. And you can see some of the themes there, online GIS emphasis in the MBA. We're going to be doing a survey of the private economic sector of GIS, working with ESRI on that. More academic research across more of our faculty. We're going to be giving a research conference on spatial business in the fall of this year on campus. We plan to have one or two GIS executives in residence, which is something new for the business school. We haven't had executives in residence before, but we think we've heard other business schools have benefited. So they come for 2 weeks and they meet with students and faculty, and it's a sharing of information. And we're going to be expanding one of our centers also. The MBA graduate students in GIS are a vital part of these initiatives. It's a good time to consider being a student in spatial business in the School of Business at the University of Redlands. That was supposed to say questions and answers. So it's now.
It says it to me.
Okay, this is discussion.
If you can read that, you get a big discount.
Special discount. This is discussion time, so.
Is that like coding?
You don't know how to code?
Much of it is Greek.
We're joking. It's an odd font.
So it's your turn.